Production funding for Ruckus has been provided by Fred and Lou Hartwig and viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Ruckus, that weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. I'm Mike Shannon. The Ruckettes join me shortly. And our topics tonight, the growing cost of government, the growing controversy over Hillary's emails, and the growing concern and confusion over the suicide of Missouri State Auditor Tom Schweik, plus roast and toast. But we start with our newsmaker segment and talk about one of the many reactions to Schweik's death. The Kansas City, Missouri City Council has unanimously approved a measure urging civility in politics and in the upcoming city elections. One of the sponsors was Councilman Ed Ford, who joins me now. Councilman, thanks very much for being with us.
Well, thanks for having me, Mike.
Talk some about the circumstances that caused you to believe that a civility resolution would be appropriate for the council to consider.
You know, after Tom Schweik's unfortunate death, I was really moved by Senator Danforth's eulogy. And one of the sentences was, "Words can kill." And with the city council elections coming up, I thought it was a good time to remind all the candidates, let's try and be civil. Let's not demean our opponents.
Is that the essence of the resolution itself?
Yes, it's what I would call a good government resolution. Just keeping in mind that for the voters, a real turnoff is when they always believe it's lesser of two evils. And you harken back to 4 years ago when Sly James and Mike Burke were running against each other, and they both ran very positive campaigns, and how good people felt.
That's seen as sort of a standard now, is it not?
It would be wonderful if that's a new standard.
Have there been widespread attacks on current members of the city council, malicious, vicious, personal attacks?
You know, I would say if you look at something like Tony's Kansas City's blog, the blog itself is bad enough, but you get into the anonymous comments, and the racial and the gender comments are so outrageous, you know. And I think that comes with the fact that you don't have to give a name; you can say whatever you want. But yeah, if anyone would ever read any of those anonymous comments, especially if it's about an African American or a woman, they certainly
those
understand
kinds
what I'm
of comments
about.
Are widespread on the internet, not just one or two blog sites.
And that may be. I mean, it's the one I occasionally look at because Tony does touch upon city government quite a bit.
Have you ever been subjected to personal attacks?
Not to that degree. You know, I've been called fat and dumb and an idiot and stupid, but you know, things that I think every elected official.
Well, that's sort of part of the game, is it not? If you're going to be in politics, you have to develop a pretty rough, tough skin.
Yeah. It's not.
Well, that's why I wonder about the Schweik suicide, and we don't know what prompted him to take his own life, and it's a sad situation regardless. But I wonder if these alleged whispering campaigns and the one radio commercial were really responsible for his actions.
And whether that was just the straw that broke the camel's back, and whether he was suffering from depression or something else, the man had an amazing resume and you know, decades of public service, and for that to put him over the edge, maybe there was other things coming out.
Do you think voters are beginning to reject candidates who resort to vicious personal attacks in their advertising?
That's the hope. I mean, if this will not end until voters start voting against the candidate who does the attacking. The biggest problem is now you have these outside committees that are not championed by the candidate itself, who then will attack the opponent. And most of the times the donors are anonymous, so you really don't know where the attack's coming from. But the candidate can say, well, it's not coming from me. I'm running a clean campaign.
And in Missouri, there's no limitation on how much money someone can give to a candidate.
There is in Kansas City on the
but not in the state of Missouri.
Not in the state of Missouri.
You're finishing the second term of your second term in the city council, actually finishing your fourth term. What will you be doing when this term ends in a few months? Are you out of politics for good?
I'm out of politics for good. I think 16 years is long enough for anyone. I've really enjoyed it, but I'm looking forward to next challenges. I still have my law practice and will continue to practice law.
If you'd be kind enough to give me some quick answers, I've got about a minute left to ask you about some other areas of city government. What's the future of Kemper Arena and the American Royal?
The American Royal's looking for greener pastures. Kemper, we're putting out a request for proposals to see if there's a good reuse for the building or if it needs to be torn down.
Is it possible then the barbecue may be held in other parts of greater Kansas City?
It wouldn't surprise me at all if the barbecue moves to Arrowhead.
Okay, do you think the next city council is likely to sanction an election to expand the streetcar system, perhaps out toward UMKC?
Yes.
And you'd be in favor of that?
I'd be in favor. If you look at the election results, it ran very well in the area basically west of Truce.
Do we need a 1,000-room hotel downtown that would be partly paid for by taxpayer money?
You need at least an 800-room hotel. 1,000 would be optimal. If you could do it where the city's credit is not at risk, I would be in favor of that.
I believe the mayor said it's getting close, or the possibility of a deal is getting close. Would you agree?
He has information I don't.
Okay. Councilman, thank you very much. I appreciate your time. That is Kansas City, Missouri City Councilman Ed Ford. Now, let's start a ruckus. Mary Ann Murray Simons is a freelance journalist and consultant. Steve Glorioso is a well-known political consultant in Kansas City. Mary O'Halloran is a media and communications consultant, and Crosby Kemper III is not a consultant. He's director of the Kansas City Library System and host of KCPT's Meet the Past program, which is on this evening, at 8 o'clock, I believe. Missouri's political culture is still trying to make sense, if that's even possible, of the suicide of state auditor and GOP gubernatorial hopeful Tom Schweik. There is some evidence the suicide was motivated by what Schweik called a whispering campaign about his Jewish heritage. Schweik, by the way, was Episcopalian. One of his grandfathers was Jewish. Missouri GOP Chairman John Hancock denies allegations that he was responsible for a whispering campaign and rejects calls to step down as chairman. Hancock does acknowledge saying he thought Schweik was Jewish, but not saying that in a way that was critical or judgmental. Crosby, I know you were very supportive of Schweik, talked about him when you were on the program a couple of weeks ago, said you would be backing him for the gubernatorial nomination. What do you see happening to Missouri politics as a result of this episode?
I think there's going to be a brief moment of silence in his honor, of civility, and then we'll go back to the way things always are. I think the problem with this is that we're trying to draw lines that can't be drawn between a political commercial and someone's personal decision to take his life. I think that's just a huge mistake. On the show that I endorsed Tom Schweik, Yale Abuhaka referred to me and my cohorts as knuckle draggers, you know, sort of ape-like beings.
One of his kinder days.
Yeah. And so I've been waiting, and the stars move towards this civility thing for to get the note from Yale about his own, you know, self-restraint or from Barb Shelley. I think it's a mistake to draw these lines.
Steve, what about John Hancock? Is he being unfairly targeted? There's no evidence that he said anything derogatory about Tom Schweik.
Well, I think there is, actually. Yes. But
what is it? Who said it?
I mean, he even admits that
he may have said, I think he's Jewish, but that's not a condemnation, is it?
Well, that's something I think is kind of left unsaid in this whole debate. What is it about the Republican base in Missouri that being Jewish is a problem for them? I mean, it's not a pejorative if you don't think being Jewish is a problem. But evidently, to the right wing of the Republican Party in Missouri, if you are labeled Jewish, you are now disqualified. And we're heading into a general election with a Jewish candidate, Jason Kander, and a senator who's married, I believe, to a Jewish person who happens to also be a lobbyist, but that's irrelevant. So what does it mean? I mean, why was it thought to be harmful to say he might have a Jewish heritage?
Well, it was thought to be harmful enough that the former Senator John Danforth was, how did he word it, outrageously angry about what had happened to his friend. I think that the story that I found most interesting was the reaction of former Senator Danforth. And, of course, he is an Episcopalian minister, mm-hmm. and the photograph on the front page of the Kansas City Star of him, fists clenched in his robes, and condemning the kind of behavior that was directed toward the state auditor. And by the way, I think it's only civil to say what a good public servant this man has been his whole life. And so there's certainly no, the tragedy of his
death. Republican candidate for governor would not have been set around this table, but that's another story.
I'm sorry.
But I think Marianne, the only real item targeted against Mr. Schweik was the radio commercial, which mm-hmm. was a very effectively done one, but I would agree it was not tasteful, very distasteful in some respects. But my question is, if you serve in public office as this man has done and run for office, aren't you going to have to be accustomed to hardball politics?
As Crosby said, Mike, we don't really know the whole story here. There may have been other personal issues at play that may have led Tom Schweik to make the decision that he made. Nonetheless, we have to figure out a way to deal with each other in a way that is not so biting and not so personally divisive.
But Marianne, doesn't that mean we have to take Ruckus off the air?
No. I don't think so. I think talking about things in a civil manner.
But are politics worse now than they have been historically at the founding of the nation? I think at that time,
more
politics was tougher then.
More publicly, I think they are because of all of the 24/7.
Well, it's a jump ball, but it's the ability to communicate to thousands of people instantly. But let me back up just a second. The key here is whether they can tie all this to Catherine Hanaway and basically ruin her campaign.
Republican candidate
Republican
for governor.
Candidate. She's clearly tied to this. Clearly, there's no doubt about it.
How?
Tied to what, Steve?
To both the ad and
the anti-Semitic thing. I agree. If Hancock actually said more than once that he's Jewish, that's a play to anti-Semitism. John Hancock should go. How do you tie that to Catherine?
Well,
Hanaway?
Because both people worked for her. Crosby, they both were consultants to Catherine Hanaway. But here's the point is, now the Democrats, we don't want her out. We don't want her out.
I'm sorry.
She's so damaged.
Association.
We want her. Oh, I don't think so.
Crosby, you know we all know what a whispering campaign is.
Right.
Whispering campaigns, people don't speak out loud and print and tell people what they're doing.
This was a campaign. This stuff happened in October and November.
And I think John Danforth told Schweik that he told Hancock that he understood what had happened, and he wasn't angry at him, and he endorsed him to continue as GOP chairman.
But again, I'm not saying if you dislike the ad or you don't like the ad or you think it's fair, same with Hancock talking about whether the guy's Jewish. The fact of the matter is there's a fear that Hanaway will drop out. And she's badly damaged. I mean, it's a godsend to the Democratic Party, so we can at least hang on to the governor's mansion. But there's a fear she'll get out, and John Bruner, who'd run for the U.S. Senate, self-financer, would step in and be a formidable candidate.
All right, we have to continue on another topic. NBC News special correspondent Tom Brokaw often talks about his UFO theory of presidential politics. The unforeseen occurs. And the unforeseen has indeed occurred on what appeared to be Hillary Clinton's clear path to the Democratic presidential nomination. The former Secretary of State used her personal email account with the server at her home during her tenure at state. When she left, she retained control of all those materials until the matter burst into the news. Mrs. Clinton says she complied with all appropriate regulations and did nothing wrong by deleting more than 30,000 communications she describes as personal communications. Now, critics say she's trying to hide her mistakes, especially over Benghazi. Supporters say this is the usual much ado about nothing. So, Marianne, what do you say?
Well, it's certainly given Fox News a lot to talk about. Every time I tune in just to see what's being said, that's the topic of discussion. My feeling is that it was a mistake, and she may have been involved in the spirit of the law, but the letter of the law it's a problem for her, and she needs to apologize for it, and they need to turn over those servers to appropriate investigators so that it all goes away, hopefully it will.
But I think she has said repeatedly, and certainly at her news conference at the UN, that she was not going to release control of the server.
She needs
Aren't they where the Whitewater documents are?
Oh, good
that's
work.
That's the inference.
Excellent. Great.
You know, it's also her husband's server, and there may be love letters to Monica in there as well.
We don't
know.
Oh,
we're way past Monica.
Come on.
There are lots more.
There are two things that I think are important about this thing. I was watching television, and I just came bouncing out of wherever it came from. People were just, Chris Matthews was just breathless. Finally, we've got her out of her house, and we're, you know, she's going to be the candidate. It's dull news time in the United States, and they needed a hot topic, and she provided it. And boy, did they take off! Law has she broken? And could this stop the campaign? And it was just wild.
Provided as the Clintons always do. The problem for Hillary Clinton is this is the endless Clinton narrative of different rules for the Clintons.
Well, did not break any rules. Well, let's be clear about what happened.
No, she may have.
Yes, she did.
Well, no, wait.
Yes, she did.
Which rule?
State Department regulations and the Obama directive that all the material be retained.
It was, well, there's a difference between a federal law and some directive somewhere.
Some directive somewhere from the president.
It was from the president,
States,
though, about transparency.
She has turned over 55,000 pages
of her email.
But she deleted 30,000, and the question is,
she
decided what was personal and not governmental.
Mike, if you were in the federal government, you would have to decide whether, is this personal or is this going into the archives?
No, but they're on government servers and government accounts.
I think getting overlooked, you know, this is, again, the Fox News, you know, issue this.
Well, it's not covered exclusively on Fox News. Every major network has covered this.
But here's the deal.
They're Democratic senators.
Would you agree that every single email she sent to someone in the federal government is retained?
No, because her two top assistants use personal accounts. Uh-huh. Her chief of staff and one of her other major assistants.
She should have used the State Department account for State Department business.
Okay, she probably should have.
All right, I want to change the topic a little bit. I want to go to Marianne here and change topics a little bit.
Yes.
She does have a problem.
Yes.
I think even Democrats and her strongest supporters say, this is not working well for her. What should she do? Just turn over the server? Is that the answer?
I think that's the answer at this point.
What advice? Well, she wouldn't be giving it out to the public. She would have someone go in and scrutinize it. An independent
observer. If
you're
going to be transparent, Mary, I think you need to.
Steve, what advice?
If we demand that everybody who works in the federal government at that level does not have any privacy on of their personal emails, we're going to have a hard time recruiting people.
They're not hiding anything.
You want to know her personal
different account. Steve, what advice would you give Mrs. Clinton?
I would I wouldn't tell her to do much more than she has for this reason. I think that she's turned over the 55,000. Yes, she made that decision. Maybe at most we'd have a third person look at it. I would never, ever turn over those servers. It's not just her, but it's the former president of the United States server, protected by the Secret Service. I just tell the Republicans, go fly a kite.
The best headline about all of this came out a day or two after this disclosure occurred, and it was, "The leader of the free world."
There you go. Well,
it is often said, and usually on this program, that the Kansas City Star has never met a tax or tax increase it doesn't like. But recently, the paper has cited the rising cost of Kansas City, Missouri government, noting that the proposed budget is 80% higher than 16 years ago, while the combined inflation rate is 36%. And the Star notes that voters get either the credit or the blame for the budget climbing to $1.5 billion. Also given credit or blame, elected officials. Paper says starting back with Mayor Kay Barnes, there have been numerous tax plans on the ballot, along with plenty of other increases. So what about this, Steve? Too many taxes and fees in Kansas City? Too big a city budget?
No, it's not. The day that Kay Barnes took office, there were 4,137 city employees. There's now 3,488. So there's been a reduction in staff of 650 employees due to consolidation, cutbacks, et cetera. We have the...
budget hasn't been cut back at all.
I'm going to get to that because the implication is that this government bureaucracy has gotten so big. It's actually gotten considerably smaller. But we have the seventh or eighth largest city in the United States in square miles. So our cost per citizen always was going to be higher. We have to run sewers all the way from the airport to Grandview. So it's going to be high. The voters did pass these things. Well, first of all, the big increase was the water department with an EPA mandate because of our combined sewers. That was into the hundreds, almost $2 billion, I think, when it's done. We were police tax for new crime lab, new station in the inner city. health levy for indigent care, a full half cent for the PI Act, the streets and bridges. We're getting more, we're spending more, and we're getting more services because the people wanted it, and the city's delivering it.
Crosby, the Kansas City Star, in one of its editorials says, residents and businesses are suffering a much larger burden than ever in financing for public safety, street maintenance, and water service. Are they getting their money's worth?
We're one of the highest taxed cities now in the United States.
They're getting their money's worth?
The city manager finally admitted that in the library when we had him and the finance director, and we're not getting our money's worth. I mean, Steve talks about the health levy. Actually, our health care spending is consistently down. We've consistently lowered our health care spending in the city budget. Where we've raised our money is in all the economic development incentives, where we're getting no jobs. We appear last. The City Observatory pointed out that we are last in job development of the 70 largest cities in the United States over the last decade. And we're spending money on things like the streetcar instead of spending money on health care. Our CDBG budget is entirely for overhead in the city, no actual housing being built. This budget is a disaster. High tax, low service.
And Mary, in the next administration, when presumably Sly James enters his second term, there are likely to be more spending programs being put forth, an expansion of the streetcar system, and it sounds like we're getting close to a plan for a downtown hotel.
It does. It does. I hope we are. Crosby, I hope that we
down
are.
Down to 2 minutes.
And also, I think that, you know, it's a fair bet that we can say that Sly James will have another 4 years. He's done, except for the little rant so last week, it got a little out of over the top. More than likely, but as Steve points out, the history of the relationship between the people of Kansas City and new taxes is pretty positive. This is not a city where people vote down taxes. Now, I have a problem with the health levy. I think more of that ought to be going to actual care mm-hmm. than to financing.
Well, the health medical department.
Well, and all the administration and so on.
All the administration
It needs to go out to the people in a more direct way. But yes, and I hope the streetcar does expand after we see that the first one is a raving success.
Mary Ann, some people find it odd that the city with a $1.5 billion budget wants to freeze salaries for nearly 7,000 city employees. Do you find that odd?
I think it's a juggling act. We talked about that when I was here a month or so ago. How do you look at pensions increasing at the same time that you look at a freeze on employee salaries? That's a tough issue, and I think some of those issues are the things that need to be looked into so that there is parity across the road. But I agree with what Mary said. You've got to let the people of Kansas City, Missouri decide if they're willing to help support the things that are being
done. Steve, is a pay freeze a good idea?
Now that my wife no longer is city administrator, probably I don't get. No, I think it's unfortunate because they do have a hardworking people. I did want to amend something. That was non-public safety decrease. We have increased because we put masks into the city budget, but any for public safety.
And Steve, there's a difference between positions and actual employees. The city's used this 600 number, and it's a phony number. It's half that is the number of real employees who were let go.
All right, we've got to move on. It is time now for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckettes heap praise or scorn on people and events in the news. And we start with Mary O'Halloran.
Well, it wouldn't be ruckus if I wasn't roasting the the governor of the state of Kansas. What's happening, there is no larger, more significant issue in our metro area and in the state of Kansas than what is happening to the dismantling of the public school finance situation in the state. The governor and his followers in the legislature have simply tossed the school aid formula out the window and going to block grants. And it's passed, and it's going to his desk. It will mean a decline in the amount of money going to schools again. The courts will not stand for it, I don't think. And we are headed, and this is what the governor wants, into a full-fledged constitutional crisis over who or how we are going to finance our schools. It is time, folks, to take note of this and to let them know to leave the school finance formula alone. But it's too late for that now. You better tell him.
All right, Steve.
Yes, I would like to roast Benjamin Netanyahu for his last-minute desperate reversal for a two-state solution. He's putting Israel on a road to apartheid. He also is endangering the public safety of Americans because that move and others does nothing to provide fodder for jihadists. We give Israel $6 billion a year in foreign aid. We ought to rethink that amount.
Crosby.
So yesterday, I took the library took 70 teens to Jefferson City and had some great meetings with state legislators, the Secretary of State's office, and then we went to the governor's office. And very well-behaved, respectful group of about 30 teenagers were protesting the 87% cut in the governor's budget for libraries in the state of Missouri. And we were thrown out, escorted out by a state trooper because they said we were too loud, which we weren't. And then they placed four guards in front of the governor's office to prevent us going in, though it didn't prevent him from sneaking out. So I toast the 70 teens of the Kansas City Public Library, and I roast the governor.
Marianne.
This is Sunshine Week, which is in recognition of our ability to be able to share information with the public about what's happening within our government. And Mary, I join you in roasting our governor for wanting to charge about $1,300 to the Wichita Eagle to be able to get information about a single email between himself and his former chief
of
staff.
That's the most important issue of this whole thing. Mm-hmm.
You're finished?
I am.
All right, and finally, a toast to longtime Ruckett Yale Abahaka, who is leaving the program after next week's show. Yale's decision is purely his own. He has been a major part of the program for years, and his significant contributions will be missed, certainly by me. I will continue to follow his work in the Kansas City Star and feel confident some of his columns will show up as topics for our discussion. And so that is Ruckus for this week. We're back next Thursday at 7. Now, on behalf of the Ruckettes and the Ruckus crew, I'm Mike Shannon saying thanks very much for joining us and good night.